I don't much like being someone who boards the bandwagon, but one thing I would like to start doing more frequently is videos about everything I watch in a given month, such as a format popularized by fellow YouTuber Karsten Rundquist, and after some deliberation, I decided to give it a try. It hit me after doing my recent video about Christmas time movie releases that there are a lot of movies that I would really love to talk about on the channel, but I often don't, since I literally don't have the time for it. And especially since March provided a whole ton of new movie releases to mull over, I realized that now is the time to try doing this in my own way. So with this, I'll do my best to be consistent each month in making this video, in which I compile a brief blip of each movie I watched in a month. These entries will be very quick, a lot of them are directly pulled from my Letterboxd entries anyway, so please give me a follow over there if you want more frequent updates on what I'm watching. Otherwise, this is all just meant to get my opinions out there. This video is not organized in chronological order either, but rather ranking them from worst to best. That being said, let's get started with Tom and Jerry. While I recognize that this movie worked for a lot of families, I did not like it at all. Yet again, Hollywood has produced a film where the titular characters, those being Tom and Jerry, are on the sidelines of what is a monotonous, cringe-inducing, and overly cynical human storyline that nobody cares about. What makes things worse is that the main characters are practically deplorable, making life decisions and operating on philosophies that are not the kind of things that impressionable kids should be exposed to. Oh well, at least Tom and Jerry themselves were portrayed pretty faithfully compared to the original cartoons, even though the cel-shaded animation didn't blend in as well with the live-action footage as it should've. If for nothing else, you could at least watch this movie for the clips of these two going at each other, but then again, that's what the cartoons are for, just watch those. Up next, we have Jumper. Even though I recorded this on my Letterboxd diary on Saturday, April 3rd, I'm counting this as a March movie since my wife and I watched the first half during the last week of March before falling asleep. Needless to say, once we finally did finish it while eating takeout on our couch, it was easy to see why it put me to sleep. And no, it doesn't really have to do much with Hayden Christensen, for he may have given a weak performance, but he wasn't the deal breaker. Rather, Jumper operates on a solid idea, you know, guy gets random superpowers and uses them for selfish reasons, but then that very concept is wasted by baboon-brained movie logic, a super short runtime, and extremely toxic main characters. Yep, sounds like a failed high-concept movie to me. And then we come to the SpongeBob movie, Sponge on the Run. Being part of the crowd that has loved seasons 1 through 3 of the show in addition to the original movie, the thought of getting another movie without the late Steven Hillenburg's blessing just did not sit well with me. And yeah, the movie didn't end up being good. A lot of it was simply unfunny and aimless, with no real legs to stand on as it moved from one sidestepping sketch to the next. Not only that, it also spends a significant portion of its time making shameless tie-ins to that new Camp Coral show on Paramount Plus. I doubt that anyone with an ounce of nostalgia for SpongeBob will appreciate what this movie's trying to do, given how frequently it misses the mark with its humor, and for how much it actively retcons this universe. But hey, at least the animation looked really good for transitioning a 2D cartoon into CGI. Next, we've got a documentary called The Last Blockbuster. I loved going to my local Blockbuster as much as any other 90s or early 2000s kid, but this movie honestly pissed me off on a regular basis. It's the kind of documentary where I'm just starting to get into whatever's being presented to me, and then immediately after I think, that defines practically every scene of this movie, since rather than actually carving out some interesting story about the last Blockbuster store in existence, that being in Bend, Oregon, instead it is a mangled mess of an edit, focusing so much more attention on random talking heads, some celebrities, others just regular people, all of which talk the nostalgia talk. That approach only took the movie so far for me, because the downfall of Blockbuster is such a fascinating story, and it's shafted for a documentary that can never make up its mind as to what it's really saying. Honestly, if you want a good, concise, and really entertaining summary of why Blockbuster died out, go check out Charlie's video. The link is in the description below. The next one we've got is Chaos Walking, which honestly, I don't think this is quite the travesty that some are touting it to be. There is at least merit to some of the performances, visual design, and Tom Holland's character who is the victim of toxic indoctrination. I can't say that this is really a film that rose from the ashes of its troubled production though. The result of Chaos Walking being passed from one set of hands to the next is not a bucket of cringe, but rather a whole lot of dull, unexplored potential. It plays things a little bit too serious for the light humor to work, and for any of the action to be that fun or exciting. As someone who hasn't read the source material, I can't vouch for how faithfully it adapts the first novel in the series by Patrick Ness, but given the execution, I can say that if you've seen one generic young adult film adaptation, you've seen them all. Chaos Walking is a somewhat more creative and tolerable film compared to its competition, but its mediocrity and messiness could nonetheless be attributed to the executives who probably forced this to be less special than it could have been. Next is The Transporter. My wife and I go back and forth choosing movies to watch on nights we have off together, and she chose this one very early in the month. She'll watch pretty much anything that has Jason Statham in it, so you can probably guess who picked this one. The Transporter's fine, and it does have some cool car chases and fight scenes, but otherwise it just doesn't really do much for me. There have been many movies made about getaway drivers, and in my opinion, this is not one of the better ones. Next, we have the biggest sensation in the world right now, Godzilla vs. Kong. It felt great to finally go watch some big event movie with the boys, for the last one we all saw together was Sonic the Hedgehog pre-pandemic. Lo and behold, it was both a retread of a lot of what annoyed me about King of the Monsters, and a significant improvement on other aspects. For one thing, the kaiju fights are at least much better. The colors, screen space, and storyboarding allowed the fight scenes to be grand in scale, but also easy for the eyes to follow. Therefore, there was much more fun to be had. None of the action scenes on their own really disappoint, especially those final 20-ish minutes that will satisfy most paying moviegoers. But otherwise, the writers on these movies still have not learned that we don't give a single crap about boring, bland characters being used as vessels for the most predictable expository dialogue you can imagine. The storyline with Millie Bobby Brown, Brian Tyree Henry, and Julian Dennison should have been removed entirely or just absorbed into the other human storyline, for I didn't mind as much when the people aiding King Kong were on screen. It's also kind of hilarious that this movie actively reworks Batman vs. Superman in a lot of ways, in addition to not paying attention to the millions of lives lost due to collateral damage when the original Godzilla had human loss as an actual, thoroughly encompassing theme. It's an improvement over the previous installment to be sure, and I'm optimistic about how this movie will bring back the theater industry to normal, but its story should have been reworked to make this an even more impactful film than what it actually ended up being. Directly following that, I have Zack Snyder's Justice League, but I made a full review for this one, so please check out the video listed in the description below. Up next is You're Next. Prior to watching Godzilla vs. Kong, the only other Adam Wingard movie I had seen was his abominable adaptation of Death Note, which gets even worse if you go back and watch the original anime. So, I wanted to get a better impression of him. You're Next is the first of two movies that I watched of his, in which I will mention the other one later. While You're Next is significantly better than Death Note, I still can't say this worked as well for me as it did for other people back in 2013. It mainly has to do with the fact that it doesn't really get fun to watch until much later. Not that I don't appreciate delayed gratification, for I absolutely do. It's more a matter that prior to the third act, the storyline, character interactions, and even the violence are just mean-spirited. The kills are as gory as any bloodthirsty horror fan would want, yet they never really feel that investing to behold because the tone of the movie just felt off from the get-go. Still, the movie does ultimately get better as it goes on, especially once we learn more about Sharni Vinson's goat final girl, Erin. If for nothing else, watch this movie for her. The next one I've got is Mortal Kombat, the original 1995 film, and I'll be talking about this more in a video coming hopefully towards the end of this month. Next, we have Raya and the Last Dragon. I originally had planned on making a full video about this one, but as I kind of alluded to, this month has been so busy for me that I had to cancel or shift around a lot of my video plans. That being said, Raya and the Last Dragon was decent, but far weaker than what I was hoping for. While this is one of the more accomplished works to come from Disney Animation Studios within the past decade or so, it certainly is dazzling and much more tonally sound than other movies they've made post-Renaissance. But if you've ever seen Avatar: The Last Airbender, the ways this film echoes that show's plot, themes, and even characters might just be an underwhelming crutch for your experience like it was for mine. I don't know how else I could perfectly describe my feelings on this movie other than that, so I'll just leave it there. Next, we've got Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. March was my month to catch up on a lot of the Oscar nominees, and I still have a couple more to watch, but among those that I've seen, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom affected me the least. I just can't say that I loved the story as a whole, which probably could have been affected by the fact that it doesn't feel quite cinematic enough for me to grab my attention, but all that's been said about this being an actor's showcase holds very true. All of the actors do well to enliven the dialogue penned by August Wilson, but the late Chadwick Boseman is a force forceful highlight that will forever remain a high mark on his legacy. Come to the movie for Chadwick, and I guarantee you'll stay for him, along with the fascinating way it examines early 1900s black identity struggles through monologue and music. Now here's one that might surprise you due to its ranking, but we got Howl's Moving Castle. In the time that passed since I first saw this in the theater in 2017, I assumed that I was just in a bad mood that particular evening. The general consensus from other people seemed to be that Howl's Moving Castle was a beautiful piece of work, much like Miyazaki's other films, with many calling it their personal favorite of the bunch. In comparison, I just didn't think much of it. What surprised me on the second watch though is that I still pretty much felt the same, and this time I was really excited to show it to my in-laws. This movie does indeed have a ton of charm to it, between its playful sense of humor, amazing animation, and Calcifer being the most adorable side character ever created. I can't fathom the idea that someone could hate this movie simply because of how fun and well-crafted it is, but the story is just so disjointed and haphazard with everything it does that I find little to gain from its narrative other than act selflessly and war is bad, in which those undoubtedly valuable themes weren't explored with that much nuance. I'd be willing to watch this every now and then since it is a quality production, but I'd be quicker to watch other Miyazaki movies to get an experience that's satisfying both aesthetically and narratively. The next one we have is The Father. Watching this made me feel weird, but also still satisfied by the artistic experience I got from it. My maternal grandmother passed away due to dementia in 2017, so it was definitely personal to not only confront this tough subject in such a frank manner, but also since Olivia Colman looks like a 40-year-old version of her. The Father, in my opinion, takes a much more respectful and thoughtful approach to the subject of dementia than the frustrating 2020 horror film Relic, yet I still felt a slight emotional distance from it notwithstanding my family's history. Call it another inductee into my canon of movies that I greatly respect but would likely never watch again. Anthony Hopkins turns in outstanding work here, but I'm rooting for another lead actor to win the Oscar on April 25th, who I will mention later in this video. And now we arrive at the other Adam Wingard movie I watched prior to Godzilla vs. Kong, which is The Guest. And I gotta say that I like this one much more. It just has good freaking vibes, man. I wish I could have watched this all in one sitting, since I was enjoying what Adam Wingard brought to the table here, but alas, fatigue forced me to split it across two different evenings. The Guest is a legitimately enjoyable experience regardless of that, though. From what I've seen of this director's work, he cannot seem to figure out how to end his movies properly, but Wingard harnessed his tone and the movie relished in it, with the sudden burst of violence being especially impressive considering what was accomplished on such a meager $5 million budget. Anyway, I don't care if David was a murderous psychopath, I want one. That Dan Stevens guy is a hunk. And then like most people who have Disney Plus, I went and watched WandaVision. But like the Snyder Cut, I also have a full review of this on my channel, so check it out if you want to hear more of my full opinion on this series. Ranked just above WandaVision is Creed 2, in which I watched this for a video coming out either later this month or in May. Stay tuned for more on this one. Now this is one you probably never heard of, but I have Lamb of God, the concert film, ranked just above that. This is a musical rendition of what is essentially the last days of Jesus' life as depicted by the New Testament. For anyone who doesn't like the idea of watching clips of cameras weaving in and out of shots of musicians, and have that be it for the visual side of the experience, this won't change your mind. But for those who would appreciate such a production, you would be in for a highly effective musical sensation. This oratorio has the kind of power to touch the hearts of all sorts of Christians, for one thing, but I would also think that it could speak to anyone irrespective of faith. If nothing else, Rob Gardner, who was born and raised in my hometown, composed music that is nothing short of inspired, and this particular performance of it takes the music to an angelic height. Accuse me of hyperbole if you will, but indeed, this concert film took what was already a great composition and made it even more affecting. The concert itself is a marvelous assemblage of music that faithfully portrays the Easter story, even though the film may not be quite as interesting to look at, since the editing pattern does get a tad repetitive. At least check out the soundtrack on YouTube if going to a theater is not a viable option for you. And now getting back to the Best Picture nominees, we arrive at Nomadland. Nomadland is to 2020 as Arrival was to 2016. They're both films whose messages and storylines were obviously not intended to be therapeutic for those enduring the specific challenges that were brought upon them during their respective release years, but end up being relevant anyway. After suffering a year of economic catastrophe and tragic losses of human life, the likes of which Frances McDormand's Fern is coping with here, it's nice to see a movie which reckons with such real-world pains yet feels so human, comforting, and life-affirming. Instead of doing some kind of ostentatious, self-important treatise on the Great Recession like The Big Short did, Chloe Zhao never loses sight of the people, the Americans who truly lost something from the system that failed them. Watching them act on the human spirit and live for the future despite their circumstances makes for great cinema. Since the camera and script choose to not dramatize anything, but rather focus on the quiet solace of living truly free. Like Zhao's previous film, The Writer, I can't say that the film itself always had me gripped due to her strictly no-plot approach, but her method of experimenting with non-actors playing versions of themselves still yielded fascinating, moving results. But a Best Picture nominee I liked more was Judas and the Black Messiah. This movie did exactly what it needed to in order to convey the feeling of white oppression from two completely different perspectives that converge in a truly tragic way, especially since the events depicted here are true. While I can't say that I was always engaged in the movie from moment to moment, Judas and the Black Messiah is worthy of the award season hype it's received. Performances across the board are absolutely phenomenal, the technical execution is extremely solid, and it has this sickening vibe that will stick with you and cause you to dwell on the sad state of things for a community still struggling to reach full equality. Fans of political thrillers, socially charged dramas, and just good filmmaking in general will find much to love here. Devastatingly powerful stuff for sure. And next, we have 101 Dalmatians. I bought this Lego set to add some unique flavor to our home decorations, and it was a surprisingly complex set to put together, so I wanted to have something playing in the background. Given that Cruella is coming out next month, I thought it would be a good excuse to revisit the original animated film from 60 years ago, and yeah, I really love this one. I don't have much further to say about it at the moment since I would like to talk about it more during a future video, but even so, this is easily one of my favorite Disney animations. It's fast-paced, suspenseful, and has perhaps one of my favorite comedic moments in a Disney movie ever.
Blast this pin! Blast this wretched, wretched pin!
Ranked just above that is Creed, and just like with Creed 2, I will be talking about this one in a video coming soon. Next, we have a movie I've been wanting to see for a long, long time, and that is The Departed. And it absolutely did not disappoint. A caveat I should leave with you about this movie is that, with it being as grand in scale as it is, on top of me being somewhat tired while sitting in a theater on a Tuesday night, I might need to watch it a second time in order to have a more informed opinion on this contemporary police thriller. But even so, don't assume because of what I just said that I didn't have a fulfilling experience with The Departed, because I absolutely did. Martin Scorsese went all in with this layered, hard-edged American remake of an equally respected Hong Kong film Infernal Affairs. I was wrapped up in the performances, the energy of the dialogue, and how wonderfully crafted the film was from start to finish. Scorsese lives up to every statement he has ever levied upon Hollywood, for with each and every movie he has produced, the man has given us a taste of what real showmanship and artistry looks like in popular filmmaking. And then there's Sound of Metal. Again, we come to a movie that I don't want to say too much about at the moment, and that is primarily because I want to save most of my thoughts for when I talk about my favorite movies of 2020 very soon. But yeah, I freaking adore this movie. Out of all the movies that got nominated for Best Picture, this is the one I would be happiest to see win. It probably won't due to the lack of A-list star power it has, on top of it just not having the exposure that something like The Trial of the Chicago 7 had, but for me, it carried the greatest sense of emotional weight and dramatic depth out of all the movies in the running to win Best Picture. I'm looking forward to talking about this movie in a couple of weeks. But the best movie I watched in March 2021 was undoubtedly Terminator 2 Judgment Day. How can someone not like Terminator 2? It's one of the greatest action movies of all time, and is a genuine achievement in filmmaking. While some aspects of the CGI are obviously dated, this movie still looks and flows like magic. Each scene has a purpose either for advancing the plot or the characters, and what's even more impressive is that every single action scene is memorable. A lot of this is owed to James Cameron's perfectionism, in which I would completely understand if someone argued that he is meticulous to a toxic degree, but the results of his work more than validate his approach to filmmaking. Almost all of the effects in action are practical, making the stunts, explosions, and combat come across as authentic and tense. But beyond the impeccably crafted set pieces, Thankfully, James Cameron held all of these things together with a fascinating and emotionally resonant story that successfully builds upon what the original established. Terminator 2 does lose its predecessor's horror edge by making the T-800 John Connor's protector, but it more than makes up for that by allowing Arnold Schwarzenegger to turn his most iconic character into perhaps the best example of a robotic hero in all of cinema. Both Sarah and John Connor also have great arcs that are dramatically satisfying on their own terms. I pity anyone who gets to watch this movie for the first time, because even after existing for 30 years, it is one of the most exciting accomplishments in action filmmaking, and one of the best sequels of all time, if I might add. And that's pretty much it. On a side note, I've also been watching a lot of Whose Line Is It Anyway with my wife. It's kind of been our nightly watch before going to bed routine due to how hysterically funny it is. With how stressful and draining both of our daily lives get at times, this timeless classic of American comedy is what we often need to unwind right before letting sleep overcome us in preparation of a new day. HBO Max putting this incredible series on their platform is one of the greatest gifts they could have given to their subscriber base. Otherwise, what did you think of the first of what will hopefully become a long-running series of videos? If you liked what you saw, please let me know in the comments, and let me know what you watched in the month of March as well. Also, if you'd like to support the channel, please consider subscribing, as well as joining the notification squadron so that you don't miss out on future videos, the likes of which I hope to make more of in the shorter span of time moving forward, now that I'm a little less busy. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you all have a great one.